Well, first of all, we want to express appreciation to Professor Eric Heyer, who's the Faculty Coordinator of Asian Studies. Professor Heyer is responsible for today's lecture and helped make arrangements to bring Professor Thawnghmung to campus today. As I mentioned, Professor Ardeth Thawnghmung is Chair and Professor of Political Science at the University of Massachusetts Lowell. Her research areas include Myanmar and Southeast Asian politics, ethnic politics, and political economy. The topic for today's presentation, opportunities and challenges in Myanmar's democratic transition. Please join me in welcoming to BYU Professor Thawnghmung.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for having me here. And first of all, I would like to thank Professor Eric Heyer for his effort in bringing me here. It's such a pleasure to be here. I feel like I'm on vacation, not for a talk. So today, my talk focuses on opportunities and challenges in Myanmar democratic transition. Let's try this, okay. So let me first begin with a brief background of Myanmar to demonstrate why democratic transitions in Myanmar is very unique, very significant for the people in Myanmar, as well as how it has important theoretical and policy implications for other countries facing similar situations in Asia, Africa, and Middle Eastern countries. So let's talk about the situation before Myanmar transits to democracy in 2010. What was Myanmar known for? Okay, so first of all, Myanmar was considered one of the longest military regimes in the world. Before that, it was under the British colony, and it gained independence in 1948, and it was under civilian government for a brief period of time. And in 1962, the military government took over power. And since then, until 2010, Myanmar has been ruled by a military regime. And it's considered one of the government with the longest lasting military regimes in the world. Secondly, it is also considered one of the most repressive. It was considered one of the most repressive regimes in the world. It was considered one of the six countries with the worst record of human rights and religious freedom. So for instance, in 2006, it was considered the worst of the worst regime by Freedom House and Human Rights Watch, along with countries like Syria and North Korea and Zimbabwe. And it was also considered the most repressive, aggressive, and rogue nation state. So thirdly, it was also considered one of the countries with the longest civil war in the world. So since 1949, Myanmar gained independence, the country was mired in civil war between the government and many armed groups, most of them represent different minority ethnic groups. And the war has continued up to this day. And I think the only country that is comparable, similar situation is Colombia, where the government engaged in war against the FARC, which is Marxist-oriented non-state armed organization since 1964. And finally, it was also one of the poorest countries in the world. About 37.6% of the populations of people live under poverty and are currently living under poverty, which means that they are living on about $2 per day. And the per capita income is about $1,100. And this is the national data, but in some areas, such as in Chin State and in Rakhine State, poverty is as high as 70 and 75%. So if you look at the level of freedom enjoyed by different regions, as defined by Freedom House annual evaluations, you can see that the green areas are the ones that are considered completely free, and these are North America and Western European countries, and the red one being not free, and the one in the middle are partially free. And here, Asia, where Myanmar is located, is considered a partly free region. And then, in terms of political system, you can see that many governments in Asia, Africa, and Middle Eastern countries are either hybrid regime, which is partially democratic and partially authoritarian regimes, or authoritarian regimes. So transition to democracy in Myanmar is considered very important, very significant internally, because for people in Myanmar who have been endured under the military regimes for so long, it's a significant situation. And it's also, Myanmar case also represents an important comparative case study for countries that are trying to move from authoritarian regimes to democratic systems. So let's look at a very briefly chronology of Myanmar transition democracy. So Myanmar was ruled by the military between 1962 and 2010. And for the most part under this period, it was characterized by extreme political repression and government controls of all aspects of economic activities and individual life. And I grew up during this period in Myanmar in the 70s and 80s. And during that time, criticizing the government or government policy could land you in a jail. For instance, in 1988, there was a popular demonstration against the government, which spread to the whole country. But the government brutally cracked down on demonstrators, killing at least 3,000 people. And during that time, assembling more than five people was considered illegal. And the government also practiced isolationist policy and restrict foreign investment. And they were very, very highly suspicious of foreigners. So for instance, in the 80s, tourists were not allowed to stay in the country for more than a week. And Professor Eric was in Myanmar for a week during that time. So due to international pressure and economic crisis because of the mismanagement of the economy, the military government decided to have elections in 2010. But elections was manipulated by the military to make sure that the party created by the military government, which is called the Union Solidarity Development Party, won a landslide victory. So people were not very optimistic, right? Because they saw this as a continuation of military rule because it was the party created by the military government. But to many surprise, this quasi-military government, once they came to power, started introducing a number of political and economic reforms, even though they were composed predominantly of ex-military generals, ex-military officers, and military representatives. So they started releasing political prisoners, including famous opposition leaders. They invited exiled opposition leaders. They lifted restrictions on freedom of expression. They broke down the monopoly of the state economic enterprises. And so this opening space also allowed the people to be less afraid to criticize the government authorities and local authorities. And the government also allowed foreigners to come in, especially civil society organizations, non-profit international organizations, to come in to the country and work on humanitarian and other resolution of conflicts in the area. So this is really exciting period of time, especially people like me who has been doing research in Myanmar for the past 20 years. In the past, in 2000, we were very afraid. We were very concerned about the safety of our respondents. We're concerned about our safeties because the military government put strong restrictions on research activities. But starting 2011, the government not only recognized and acknowledged the importance of advices by academics and scholars, but also started acknowledging the importance of research institutes and evidence-based policy researchers. So we were also able to conduct research more freely in the country. So because of this, because of all these, the lifting of restrictions on political and economic affairs, the government was very confident. They thought that they would win the next elections in 2015. But to their surprise and to many surprise, the National League for Democracy, which is the opposition party, won a landslide victory in 2015. So this is the National League for Democracy. It was formed in 1988 under the leader of a very charismatic leader, Dr. Aung San Suu Kyi, who has been under house arrest in and out for the past 25 years, and who endured a lot of hardships along with all these opposition movement leaders under the military regime. She became a natural leader, even though she was not raised. She did not grow up inside the country. Her father was a famous nationalist hero who brought independence to Myanmar, but who was assassinated in 1948. So she grew up most of her life in India and then later in United Kingdom, married to a British scholar. So she spent most of her life in foreign countries, but in 1988, during the popular demonstration, she came back to the country to care for her ailing mother, and this period was coincided with the popular demonstration against the government. And so she immediately rose to become the leader of opposition movement, not only because of her father, but also because she was very charismatic, very articulate, and she was not afraid to speak out against the government. So it was really exciting period. This is the first time in history in Myanmar, right, where in the history of Myanmar since 1962, where the popularly elected civilian government came to power. And people were having high expectations. They were very happy. And if NLD came to the National League for Democracy, came to power, there would be, you know, the country will be filled with, you know, peace and prosperity. The foreign direct investment and humanitarian assistance will be flowing inside the country. So everybody was very excited. However, let's look at 1 year after the National League for Democracy came to power. You would expect that things would be much better in economic, political, and social fronts, but it seems like, well, given that the NLD, the government, has a legitimate support from the population as well as international support, but 1 year after the NLD came to power, there seems to be a lack of progress on these fronts. So the question is that why this happened? So to understand that, we need to look at broader political environment as well as structural challenges that constrain the government to act autonomously, as well as the leadership style of Aung San Suu Kyi. And there are many, many problems. As I have already mentioned, Myanmar has an economic, social, political problem. So because of time limitation, I'm just going to focus on three main challenges confronting Myanmar. The first one is military. The second one and the third one, it has to do with the relationship among ethnic and religious minority populations. So military, even though the military has withdrawn from managing day-to-day government affairs, they still exercise considerable influence in the government through the 2008 constitutions that they drafted and imposed on the country. So according to the 2008 constitution, the military has 25% reserve seats for the legislative seats. So they didn't really have to run for the election. They automatically have all the 25% of the legislative seats. And the constitution also says that in order to amend the constitution, you need to have more than 75% of the votes from the legislative branch. And it's very difficult because the military control 25% of all the legislative seats. And the constitution also endowed the military with the authority to safeguard the constitution. The commander-in-chief, and not the president, appoints three important cabinet positions, which are defense, home affairs, and border affairs. And it is the commander-in-chief, not the president, who controls all the armed forces, including police and paramilitary forces. And also, you can see here that the military also controls six positions in the National Defense and Security Council. National Defense and Security Council is a very important body under the 2008 Constitution that gets to determine important security issues. And out of the 11 positions, six are controlled by the military. Okay. So, despite that, in addition to that, Aung San Suu Kyi is not eligible for president, even though she is the leader of the opposition party that won a landslide victory, because the constitution prohibits candidates whose husbands and children are foreign citizens. Her late husband and her children, her two sons, are British citizens, so she is not eligible for the presidential candidate. However, it seems that since the NLD came to power in 2006, it seems that Aung San Suu Kyi, this leader, was able to eventually expand her power gradually. First of all, even though she was not eligible to for president, she picked a presidential candidate who was her childhood friend, who was very loyal to her. And even before NLD won the election, she said in the interview that she will be above the president. Right. So she was. That's the first thing that she did. And the second thing is that she assumed the positions of the Minister of Foreign Affairs and Presidential Office. These are the two very important positions in the current government. And you can see that if you're the Minister of Foreign Affairs, you also get to sit in this very important National Defense and Security Council. And immediately, NLD government took over power. The legislature, which is now predominantly composed of the NLD elected members of parliament, passed a bill to create a special position for her, which is called the state councillor position. And this position is similar to a prime minister, where that would allow her to consult not only the executive branch, but also the legislative branch. And she also chairs many committees. So you can see here that since 2016, after the military, the NLD came to power, the leader, Aung San Suu Kyi, was also able to gradually expand her power. So the military remains a formidable challenge to the NLD government. The second challenge that is facing the new government is the deep-seated tension and hostility among different ethnic and religious groups in the country. Myanmar is one of the most diverse countries in the world, and you can see here, Burma or Myanmar are the majority population. They constitute about 68% of the populations. The rest of the populations are divided among seven smaller ethnic groups and hundreds of sub-ethnic, sub-language groups. And many of the minority ethnic groups feel they share grievances against Burma, who dominated the military and the government, and who practice policies that undermine the culture and survival of minority groups. However, these minority groups are represented by a variety of organizations, including armed groups, political parties. So after Myanmar gained independence, more than 30 ethnic armed groups took up arms against the central government to fight for greater autonomy and independence. And the military government since 1962 practiced harsh military measures against these armed groups, as well as civilian living under the ethnic armed groups, while putting restrictions on cultural and cultural preservations of activities of minority groups. Since 1990, the government wiped out some of the non-state armed groups, ethnic minority armed groups, through military means, and then signed ceasefire agreements with a few of them, but continued to engage in military campaign against the remaining armed groups. But for the most part, under the military government until 2010, there was really no sustainable solution to address the roots of grievances by the minority populations. And this has changed in 2011, after this quasi-military government came to power, and they were able to come up with one of a kind over the period of the military government called nationwide ceasefire agreements. The government was able to bring all the armed groups together to agree to draft these nationwide ceasefire agreements. And why was this successful? Because throughout the military government, ethnic armed groups and the government tried to reach some sort of agreements, but they were never able to come up with a sustainable, long-lasting solution. So the question is, why? Why were they able to come up with nationwide ceasefire agreements? First of all, the government said that the armed groups do not have to lay down arms. Right. So, for instance, if you think about Colombia, the Colombia government is also signed ceasefire agreements with the FARC, but their ceasefire agreement is that the FARC has to agree to lay down arms, and they were almost treated like a criminal. And one of the agreements over there is that there will be reduced sentences for these non-state armed actors. But in Myanmar case, they did not talk anything about punishments for the armed groups, because the ethnic minority groups were all the time, for over the period, thought that they were fighting for the right cause. They were fighting for greater autonomy, more freedom for ethnic minority groups. So they were never considered themselves criminal. So according to this nationwide ceasefire agreements, non-armed groups do not have to lay down arms. There is no discussion about punishments of human rights violations by both sides. They're not going to talk about that. But what they agreed to talk about is federal arrangement. The country has always been under extremely excessive centralized government, and that was really the reason why minority ethnic groups decided to take up arms, resistance against the government for greater autonomy and for federalism. So the government said that, come, we will talk, but you don't have to lay down arms. You will not be treated as criminals if you agree to this. And then we'll talk about federalistic arrangement, because up until 2011 in Myanmar, you cannot talk about federalism. The government, it was the term that was banned. So we call it the F word. Nobody dare talk about the F word. But after 2011, both the government and the military began to, even though they have a different ideas about what this federalism will look like, and it's completely different from what the armed groups envisioned, they agree that we are going to talk about federalistic agreements. And the other unique things about this nationwide ceasefire is that it was truly indigenous process with no third-party mediation, and although it was funded by foreign governments and organizations. So this is a complicated a chart that basically, according to this nationwide ceasefire agreement, all the groups will move forward with the peace dialogue. That they will start with the grassroots level, where they will try to get inputs from the grassroots populations, which will then culminate into, you know, peace conference that will be attended by different segments of stakeholders, including government, political parties, military, armed groups. And they will talk about the arrangement for federal government, and they'll talk about economic issue, they talk about security issue, they talk about everything, and they will approve the agreements, and eventually the agreements will be adopted by the parliament. So it seems like initially everybody that involved in the negotiations agreed to the principles, but when it come to signing the ceasefire agreements, only 8 groups ended up signing the agreements, even though 20 groups were involved in negotiating the agreements, because the military government refused to include 3 smaller armed groups that they did not think it was a legitimate ethnic armed organizations. And when the military declared its intention, the rest of the armed groups said that the process was not inclusive enough. So you can see here, currently, there are only 8 armed groups that signed the ceasefire agreements and are now preparing and have done this, have already gone through this process. And then you also have 7 groups that are thinking about signing the ceasefire agreements. And then finally, you have 5 groups, right, that are not, that are fighting against the government currently. So the military government the NLD government is now facing different challenges with different groups. There are 3 main challenges with the ethnic groups here. First of all, they need to move forward with the nationwide ceasefire agreements to implement the nationwide ceasefire agreements, this process that I'm talking about, right? And then the second one is to convince non-signatories to sign the agreements. That's another challenge. And currently, they have not been able to convince the non-signatories to sign the ceasefire agreements. And then finally, to find ways to stop armed conflicts between Myanmar army and a few armed groups. And this is the area that NLD claimed that they were not allowed to have an input because it has to do with the security military issue. But many people think that the NLD has been keeping remaining silent because maybe they agree with the military strategy of engaging in military campaign against these 3 groups. So many minority ethnic groups who voted for the NLD government and for Aung San Suu Kyi were increasingly getting disillusioned with her silence. So for a long time, she didn't really say anything about the atrocities that were the result of the atrocity among the civilian that were the results of the military campaign. And 2 weeks ago, she finally visited the internally displaced refugee areas and refugee camps. And even then, many people think that she was not very sympathetic. So what are the performance in the 2 measures? Because the first 2 challenges, it seems like the NLD, the military, allowed the NLD to have a say over the first 2 areas. But even the first 2 areas, the current government has limited success. Why is that? So first of all, the NLD said that, okay, even though the nationwide ceasefire agreements was initiated by the previous government, we will honor it. However, the government, Aung San Suu Kyi, reshuffle all the leading individuals who engage in the official mediating team. So, and then she stacked them with the people who are loyal to her. The problem with this is that the people who are loyal to her do not know much about ethnic conflicts, do not know much about the history. And in addition to that, she did not give them full authority. She did not delegate enough power to them. So she exercised extreme control over every small decisions that have been made. So that's considerably slowed down the process of the implementation of nationwide ceasefire agreements. So her personal style was also considered to be one of the prohibiting factor in the in this process. So many people said that she likes to micromanage things. She is unwilling to delegate authority. And she also imposed strict party discipline and loyalty with very little tolerance for criticism. So these are a combinations of the reasons why in the two areas that the civilian government is allowed to make a decision, they have not made much progress in that. So the last challenge that is facing the NLD government is the treatment of the minority populations, Muslim, who are considered, they refer to themselves as Rohingya in western part of Myanmar, in Rakhine State. So in Myanmar, the majority of people are Buddhist. They constitute about 80% of the populations. Christians are about 6.4, and Muslims are about 4.6% populations. However, the Muslim concentrated there is a heavy concentration of Muslim in this area. So this is a Rakhine State. It's a occupied by resided by Rakhine Buddhists, but it's about 3 million populations. But Muslim constitute 1 million populations in that area, and Buddhists constitute the rest of the population. So the Buddhists see these Muslims as a threat to Buddhist culture and civilization. And they have been there for a long time, especially during the British colonial period. After the British occupied the area, there were an influx of populations from Bangladesh. So the Burmese people, Burmese Buddhists, and Burmese government never consider currently, they don't want to consider these people as indigenous populations. But the Rohingyas would like to be would like the Myanmar government to consider them as indigenous populations, even if they are not officially considered indigenous populations. They have been there for so many generations, but many of them, only a handful of them, are Myanmar citizens. And so there has been a lot of tension, hostility between these two groups since British colonial period. And under the military government, there were violence and communal riots in this area. But it never spread to the rest of the country because of the tight control. The situation was tightly controlled by the military government. However, the situation exploded under the freer political environment started in 2011, which spread to the rest of the country and resulted in the emergence of extreme groups from both sides. And it got worse. In 2016, extremist Islamic groups attacked the border post of the Myanmar police, which resulted in a retaliation by the Myanmar military, and resulted in torture, rape, and violations of human rights among the Muslim populations. Right now, about 100,000 of them are in refugee camps. Tens of thousands of them already fled the area. So it's a deplorable situation. So the situation in Rakhine, it has so many layers of problem. It's multiple. It's a multi-layer. So one of the problems that is facing the NLD is that, first of all, the Muslim minority populations would like to be considered by the Myanmar government as indigenous population. But the Myanmar government would never consider them indigenous. Currently, the indigenous population is called Dayin Da. Currently, there are only 135 groups that Myanmar government is willing to consider as indigenous. And so in Myanmar, according to the law, if you are considered indigenous Dayin Da population, you automatically can become full citizen. So there are like three different types of citizenships, and full citizenship, you get certain benefits. And if you constitute a majority in two townships, you get to have this self-autonomous region status. So it's considered to be the superior form of citizenship. So the Muslims would like to be considered an indigenous population, and they like to be referred to as Rohingyas, right? But in Myanmar, if you are inside Myanmar, it's not politically correct to refer to them as Rohingya, because Myanmar Buddhists or Myanmar government will get mad. They will say that, you know, if you call them Rohingya, that means that you recognize them as they are indigenous people. So how do the Myanmar government refer to them? They're referred to as Bengali, which means that they are from Bangladesh, right? So there's a controversy over there. So one thing is to be the Rohingyas to be accepted as indigenous population. The other problem is, okay, if you don't accept them as the indigenous populations and therefore they're not qualified for full citizenship, this day should be qualified for associate or naturalized citizenship for people who have been there for a couple of generations. But even for this process, it's very difficult because of the resistance by the Myanmar Buddhist citizens. And the other problem that is facing the NLD government is communal tension and treatment of religious minority groups, right? Their tension is there. And so there are layers and layers of problems. Do you recognize them as indigenous people? And how do you, what type of process are you going to go through in order to recognize them as citizenships, where many Burmese Buddhists are now against? And then how do you reduce the communal tension? And how do you address the human rights violations committed by the military? And interestingly, Rakhine issue is one of the few issues where the government and the people and the military share the same position, which is anti-Islamic, right? So for the NLD, they are caught in a very difficult situation. They need to balance their positions between local populations and international response, right? Because NLD is now, they need to respond to their constituents that are completely against the Rohingyas, and they also need to respond to international pressure, right? So you have two different opposing groups. So the NLD government is caught between the two opposing sides. And so, and I don't think anybody will be able to like resolve the roots cause of the problems here immediately. It's very controversial. So the only thing that the NLD government can do right now is that instead of calling them Rohingya or Bengali, Aung San Suu Kyi called them as the Muslim in Rakhine State, right? And that would not satisfy any of the sides. And because the Myanmar government at least Rakhine Buddhists would like her to refer to them as Bengali, and then the Rohingyas would like to be referred to as Rohingya. And then the other thing is that, so the next step that the NLD was able to do is just form an investigation committee composed of very prominent international leaders, including Kofi Annan. But that, again, has not satisfied neither the international constituents or the local constituents. So this remains a very, very difficult challenge for the NLD government. So to conclude everything, I have only touched on a few issues, right? I haven't really talked about the economic issues or social issue. I only touched on a few key prominent issues that are facing the challenges in the country. And but what can we say about transition to democracy here? So Myanmar faced many challenges, and there is a possibility that it could take a U-turn, it will go back to the military regime. And in many countries in Africa, Asia, this happened, and in the Middle East, it's all of for one time, it seems like the countries are moving toward democracy, but then again, it could turn back to authoritarian regime. I think that the NLD will continue to face so many challenges, and people will be unhappy. However, I think that the Burmese people are, even though they're not happy with the performance of the NLD government, I think that nobody, and I'm sure nobody, wants to go back to the period under the military regime, which was associated with extreme political and economic repression. And since 2011, the Burmese people have experienced a taste of what it's like to be living under the freer political environment. So I think that it's important for the NLD government to learn quickly from whatever mistakes or whatever limitations they have in the past, fix it so that Burma can continue to consolidate democracy. Thank you.
So we've just got about 5 minutes. We'll take a few questions. We'll go as quickly as possible because I know a lot of you have to get to your next classes. Ask you to come to the microphone, tell us your name and what you're studying, and ask your questions. Thank you.
My name is Jordan Smith, studying physiology here at BYU. And it's apparent that while the transition to democracy will continue to move forward, no matter what, because it's what the Myanmar citizenry wants, it's also apparent that the personality, the persona of Aung San Suu Kyi, is very important and involved in the day-to-day affairs of the government. So in a time in which we are post Aung San Suu Kyi, what do you see happening for the NLD and Myanmar's transition to democracy?
So long-term and let's talk about short-term and long-term assessment. So the country just in April, actually last week, we just had the midterm elections, and there were 19 seats up, 19 seats up for grab, and NLD won only 9 seats, right? So this is a wake up call for the NLD government, and then they have received a lot of criticisms especially from scholars and from international communities. And I think she was also very surprised by all these critical feedback. So it depends on how the NLD clean up its actions, right? So now they realize that she made a speech union, it's similar to the union speech, and she acknowledged all the challenges that they have to face. So if she understand and if she's aware of these challenges that they are facing and fix them, then I see that the NLD will continue to enjoy legitimacy. But even now, they still command a high level of support among the populations, because even though things have not progressed, it depends on the population's interpretation, right? So some of the citizens are saying that, oh, of course she's facing that many challenges because she has to fix the destruction caused by the military government. So many people don't blame her for that, right? It's only people who are very critical and impatient will blame her for the failure. So I think that the NLD will continue to enjoy popular support, but not as popular as it has gotten in the 2015 elections. So it will very much depend on how they respond to the situations. Okay.
Jesus.
All right, well, thanks for your question, and please join me in thanking Professor Thawnghmung.